studying the songs that the people of God write, and occasionally I get to write a song as well. This was written just a couple of weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago. So I thought I'll share that with you today. I hope it encourages you. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the grace to know you, Lord, so I can truly praise the only God every day, every day. I love you, Lord, with all my strength, my soul, my mind and heart. I want to honor you in every part, every day, all the way. Lord, I honor your name, I publish your fame, so that more will know you, Jesus, mighty to save. You're coming again. All will bow before you. One day, Lord, there'll be no pain, no pride, no sorrow, Lord. No caste, no creed divide your people, Lord. Every day, each eternal day. So, Lord, I honor your name. I publish your fame, so that more will know you, Jesus, mighty to save. You're coming again. All will bow before you. Corporations and kings, every high thing falling down before you. Wordless, fixing their gaze as worshippers pray, singing only Jesus, singing only Jesus, singing only Jesus, singing only Jesus. Lord, I honor your name, I publish your fame, so that more will know you, Jesus, mighty to save. You're coming again. All will bow before you. All will bow before you. All will bow. Philippians, Paul's letter, verse 1 to 9. Let's read that passage together, if you turn in your Bibles with me. And then we'll pray before we continue to reflect on that text. Philippians 4, verse 1 to 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. May we pray together. Our gracious God, we are bowing in your presence, having acknowledged that you are Lord of all. Corporations and kings and every high thing will fall down before you. Amen. We know, Lord, that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We come willingly, Lord, because you have saved us and you have shown yourself to us in Jesus Christ. You have poured the Holy Spirit into our hearts. And through that, we know the love of God in our own lives. We come as worshipers who love the Lord Jesus. Father, our hearts are open. Speak to us, because your word is your living word. Your scripture, Lord, comes to us as life from you. You have breathed into it so that we may hear exactly what you want us to know from your heart. Lord, help us to receive your word today. Even before we meditate on the scripture, we open our hearts, Lord, so that we may receive from you and we may do the things that you prompt us to do. We thank you today for this morning and for this act of worship by which we acknowledge that you are greater than all and we are your servants. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much for your very warm welcome. I'm very grateful to be here. It's been some time, but I always love coming to Gospel Tabernacle, and I mean that from my heart. It's one of the joys of my ministry to visit Gospel Tabernacle, because it's one of the most warm and welcoming churches, and there's so much joy in the congregation. And of course, having known Pastor Roger for so many years, it's been a joy to share ministry together. We work together also in Colombo Theological Seminary, where I serve, and he's our vice president. And he has been a rock of strength to me. But I also want to thank all of you, because in these last few months, it has been really an encouragement to have your support and prayers more than anything else, to know that you have been praying that God's word will be protected, will be upheld in Sri Lanka. And we are happy to see that all over Sri Lanka, God is raising up men and women who love his word and who love him and who are willing to stand for it. And so that has been a great encouragement, and I know Gospel Tabernacle, my wife and I, have been greatly encouraged by many of you, some of you who have been very close in contact and encouraging us and strengthening us during this time. And it's not about us at all, it is about God's word, and we are in this together. I was saying to Pastor Sean a little earlier, and I think I mentioned in the previous service, that what is happening is a new phenomenon, not just in Sri Lanka, but all over the world, where the church is growing. That as the church has been advancing, especially in the continents of Africa and Asia and Latin America, the church is advancing in an unprecedented way. But on the heels of the advancement of the church, there have been spurious teachings that are undermining the great advances. So people are coming to Christ at the front end, and people are losing their confidence in the scripture at the back end. And so we will have a new challenge, and that is, how do we help the church to stand firm in the Lord? And that is what I want to talk about today. That is how Paul begins the last section of his letter to the Philippians. You see, he has been talking to a church that he loves and delights in. And he has been just talking about the good things that they've been doing. He's appreciating them. They've been sending him gifts. They've sent him an emissary called Epaphroditus while Paul is in prison. And he has been abandoned by everyone else. Suddenly finds that this church from Philippi has not only sent money or things to assist him, but they've also sent a very important person called Epaphroditus, who has risked his life for the purpose of coming to aid Paul. And he has been assisting Paul, and it has been a great ministry. And this church has done amazing things. But Paul has appreciated them in this thank you letter. But now at the end of the letter, he begins this chapter 4 with these words. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown. What does he say? Will you read that next section with me? Stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. This is what he wants to tell them right at the end. Stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. You know, sure, the Philippian church had a great history. If you remember going back to the book of Acts, Paul comes in chapter 16 to Philippi from the province of Asia. Paul wants to minister in Asia. He thinks that's where he ought to remain. But the Holy Spirit, twice in that passage, we are told that the Holy Spirit would not allow Paul to remain in Asia, because God wants the gospel now to be spent for kingdom purposes. Jesus said, are there not 12 hours in a day when a man must work? Are there not 12 hours for us when we must work? So we must use the keys that God has given us. The relational key, the emotional key, the intellectual key, and the practical key. But very often, we ask the pastor to take care of the keys, because we are in the departure lounge. Pastor, deacons, elders will take care of the keys. But I want to remind us all that when Paul wrote Philippians in chapter 1 and verse 1, this is what it says, and we'll read it together if it will come up on the screen. Shall we read together how he begins the letter? Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's people in Christ Jesus in Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons. Pastors and deacons are coming secondarily. The letter is to all God's people. Every one of us is addressed in this letter. Every one of us has to take the responsibilities to use the keys to take the church forward. Each one of us matters. I know some of us are sitting here and thinking, I'm glad today will be just my Sunday visit and that's it. But may I ask you, brother and sister, when you and I are in the church, we are a vital part. We have to take that position. We have to take that stand. When I came to the Lord at 15 years of age, I understood what it was to be born again. And I felt that my own church didn't have an appreciation of being born again. And I had all these ideas about my church. And so the ironic thing was, when I became a believer in the Lord, I dropped out of the church. And I wasn't going to church for some time. And when somebody asked me, I would say, oh, you know, church is dead. But then the Lord taught me through the word that every one of us has a part in helping the church to be the church. Each one of us plays a vital part. On the 1st of February 2003... the Space Shuttle Columbia returned from its mission after 16 days. It entered the Earth's atmosphere. And as the NASA team was watching, it entered the Earth's atmosphere and then broke up and disintegrated, killing all 7 astronauts, including one of the first women astronauts, or Indian women astronauts in that shuttle. The question was asked, how did the Columbia disintegrate? And the answer was stunning. It was all because one tile had slipped out of place at takeoff. One tile. The shuttle is covered with tiles, but one tile slipped out of place at takeoff. And the damage that happened compromised the shuttle. I know God is sovereign. Just because one of us slips up doesn't mean the church is going to burn up and disintegrate. But I think it's important to know that each one of us, according to the scripture, is an important part of the body of Christ. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't have a need for you. No one can say, I am not necessary to the body of Christ. So Paul wants all of us to take these keys seriously. He writes it for the believers. And the first key is how we relate. Chapter 4, verse 2 to 3. I plead with you, Odia, and I plead with Suntuke to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. So the first key is how we relate. There are two ladies in the church and they are not getting on. They are not actually talking to each other at the moment. They are finding it difficult to sit at meetings together. Interestingly though, Paul does not talk of them as sinful women. He doesn't condemn them. He doesn't say either of them has made some grave error and they need to be disciplined. He's recognizing them as honorable women in the church. In fact, he says, they have contended at my side for the cause of the gospel. So they are kind of very strong women in the church, strong in the ministry. And he even reminds us that their names are written in the book of life. They are honored women, but they can't get on. Now, this certainly doesn't happen here, does it? It doesn't happen. But in every church, it does happen. Our personalities get in the way. Our experiences get in the way. Our likes and dislikes get in the way. You know, there are people that you meet for the first time and you like them before you even talk to them. Has that happened to you? Immediately something within you says, I like this person. The person hasn't said a word to you. But there are also people that you meet for the first time and they have not said a word, but inside of you, you're sure they must be lousy people. Isn't it interesting? We kind of instinctively make decisions about one another. And so this personality differences, the difference in expectations, the difference in opinions can sometimes create a rift, create a challenge to our relationship. But you see, the church is about relationships. It's about people. And the fact is, we are very diverse. And from the beginning of the church, in the book of Acts, the church has struggled with diversity. In fact, one of the things that Paul was most challenged by was the fact of the diversity of the church. And so some people were saying, you know, they are from another community and we are not able to get on with them and we should have different churches so that you can have a Gentile church and you can have a Jewish church. But Paul said, I'm ready to die for the sake of keeping the church together, because in Christ there is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither male nor female, neither barbarian nor civilized. All are one in Christ. Diversity can become the basis for our conflict, or it can be a celebration. And one of the things I love about your motto is, where background makes no difference. So Paul is saying, I urge them to resolve to become agreeable, to become one-minded, to agree with one another. I once had a situation where a brother and I in the church, we became disagreeable. Initially, it was irritating. The person irritated me, I irritated him. After some time, we got into arguments. Arguments got pretty hot. After some time, we stopped talking to each other because now it was beyond conversation. And so there was an invisible wall between us. And others knew it. I felt quite justified by it. I didn't think I had done anything wrong. He didn't think he had done anything wrong. But the matter had become fairly permanent. We are so thankful that a couple of friends recognized this, came and met us, and said, guys, we need to do something. I said, no, you know, you better talk to him. They said, yes, we'll talk to him. But will you also come and we'll talk together? And what did they do? They booked a room at one of the Chinese restaurants, a good way of doing it. So we went there and we had a good meal. And over the meal we talked. I said everything that I wanted to say. He said everything that he had to say. I had to listen to him. He had to listen to me. I can tell you though, we didn't agree with everything, but we became agreeable. We were able to shake hands. And today we are thanking God that our relationship was taken through that period because of people like these brothers who got involved and helped us when we were not able to help ourselves. Church, my dear friends, is not about buildings. It is also not about programs. It's about people. And unless we put that priority, we are going to become a church that cannot sustain itself. We have to constantly keep that priority. It's about relationships. It's about people. I fear because the church worldwide is spending so much on programs. Program after program while compromising relationships. Is there a relationship that you need to address? Is there a relationship that maybe you can help restore? Do we just ignore it? Give them different cell groups to belong to? Or do we get involved in helping them to find ways to reconnect? Even if everything cannot be resolved, but certainly some things can be made better. Psalm 133 says, how good, how pleasant it is. Will you help me finish that verse? It's there. When God's people live together in unity. How good, how pleasant. And the Lord Jesus, just on the night when he was, the night before he left, he washes the feet of people who he knows will run away from him. And he knows one of them is going to actually sell him out in a few minutes. He still washes their feet. And having done that, he says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. The church, my dear friends, is about relationships. How we relate will be the first key. Second, how we rejoice. Notice that command in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Actually, in chapter 3, verse 1, Paul has said the same thing. So he seems to be quite hung up on this. He says in verse 3, chapter 3, verse 1, further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. Now, I find two curious features about this command. First is that it is a command. Has anyone commanded you to be joyful? Parents, do you command your children to be joyful? We don't, right? Do we get commanded to be joyful? No, we usually intuitively think that's not on. But Paul commands the people of God to be joyful. Joy is a command, not an option. Did you hear what I just said? When you get a command, what are the options you have? When we are commanded to do something, what can we do? What are the two options we have? Obey or disobey. Thank you, sister. And here what Paul is doing is he's using a command. He's not suggesting, let's all be joyful. He's saying, rejoice in the Lord. And again, I will say it. In other words, this needs repetition. What's it? Rejoice. It's a command. And we kind of wonder, how can someone command me to be joyful? The second curious thing is that he says, rejoice in the Lord. When? Always. In other words, our circumstances can change. We will walk out of church today and there'll be a new president announced. Our circumstances will change. Some of us might like it, some of us might not like it. Maybe next week you will have circumstances changing. But our joy, says Paul, is not meant to fluctuate. Rejoice in the Lord, what's the word? Always. In other words, our circumstances do not determine this commitment to joy. Now, what is interesting is that in Galatians 5 and verse 22, Paul lists the fruit of the Spirit. In that he begins with, and the fruit of the Spirit is first, love. And the second, joy. Now, can we have a Christian who does not want to love? Is there a possibility? No, because the Bible says, a new commandment I give you that you love. The first commandment is, hear, O Israel, not the Lord your God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord, and you shall love your neighbor. These are commands. What's the second fruit? Joy. Can we have a Christian who is not joyful? You're not answering. This is not to say that the Christian is always meant to have a smile on his face and be happy all the time. This is not about happiness. Happiness and unhappiness cannot coexist. You're either happy or unhappy. But you can be joyful in the midst of sorrow. Are you with me? Joy is not about happiness. Joy and sorrow can coexist. A mother is saying goodbye to her daughter. She's going to study overseas. She's feeling a deep sorrow. because of the parting, but she's feeling a deep joy because of the future prospects for her daughter. Can she have both mamas? Moms? They can have both. So Paul is not saying that practicing joy means being happy all the time. It means being joyful in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. And I will say it again, rejoice. G.K. Chesterton, a great Christian writer, once said, joy is the gigantic secret of the Christian life. Isn't that a great thought? Joy is the gigantic secret of the Christian life. I fear that we fail Christ. That we present a Jesus through our lives sometimes. A joyless Jesus. People look at us to see Christ. And if we are not practicing joy, we may be undermining the image of Christ. Jesus, in the middle of being the man of sorrows, was the most joyful person people met. You know, prostitutes and drunkards and tax collectors, when Jesus came, they rushed up to him, not away from him. And you know, you can see the joy of Jesus the way children responded to him. They were rushing up to Jesus and gathering around him and hailing him because he was the most joyful person. That's why people like that, little people, gather around joyful people. Jesus was one who practiced joy. The Bible commands that we practice that joy. So the church must be both a place of rejoicing and a cause of rejoicing. The emotional key. Andrew Murray once said, joy is not a luxury or a mere accessory in the Christian life. It is the sign that we are really living in the love of God. Are you joyful? Perhaps you are not, but the command is coming to you today. What is the command? Rejoice in the Lord always. I remember that I had a time of great sorrow 31 years ago, close to this day, when my brother, 1 year older to me, was killed in a train accident in Dehival, close to Sunil's and Faith's home. And that night, I had to go to the mortuary to identify his battered body. He was almost beyond recognition. And I went back to my journal of that night. And at 12:30 at night, I had written in the journal, and I thought I'll share that with you. If I can find it. Yes. Let me just. Maybe an hour and a half after I had gone to the mortuary, I was interested that I had written these words. Shelley has gone to be with the Lord, and I praise my Lord Jesus Christ. Praise you, my Lord, my King, my all. I dedicate myself more this day that you may find glory and honor, praise and love from all those who do not know you yet. Should I declare my feelings, they are hardly clear. But one thing I do know, there is for sure, the peace that passes all understanding that guards my mind in Christ Jesus. It was wonderful for me that night to see in the midst of sorrow that I could be joyful in the things of God. And I remember God dropped a word into my head. Graduation. Your brother has graduated. And the whole funeral was a funeral of joy. Of course with sorrow, but with the joy of the Lord. And we celebrated life and we celebrated salvation. And we were able to worship God in the midst of the sorrow. Rejoice in the Lord. In verse 5 and verse 6, Paul gives us some ways in which we can release the spirit of joy. The first in verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Let your gentleness, that word gentleness actually has an additional meaning. The word can be translated as reasonableness or courtesy or agreeableness or kindness. So what is Paul saying? He's saying let your fairness, your reasonableness, your courteousness, let it become evident to all. If you have become part of a new group, like say you became a member of Gospel Tabernacle recently, or you joined a cell group recently, people don't know you. There is not much relationship one with another. But as you continue to let your reasonableness become evident to all, as you allow your fairness to be seen by all, you know what happens? People begin to trust you more. They begin to tell one another, he's an amazing guy. She's a wonderful lady. And what happens as the trust grows and your credibility grows? What happens? What grows? Your joy grows. Joy comes as a result of us developing our credibility. And so Paul says, let your gentleness, your fairness, your reasonableness become evident to all. Develop your credibility. And credibility takes time to develop. I'm afraid that the generation that is coming after us is used to getting things fairly fast. Everything can be got pretty quick, right? If you're hungry, you don't have to go through a long process of buying stuff in the market and cooking it. What do you do now? And our young people will tell us that, right? No problem, mom. I'll Uber it. Correct? If you need a reload, very quick. Everything can be got very fast. But credibility takes time to develop. And credibility releases joy. But Paul says, not only develop your credibility, but also defeat your fear. Defeat your fear, he says, in chapter 4, verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known unto God, and the peace of God will guard your hearts and your mind. Defeat your fear. Fear is such a powerful emotion. I don't know what fear is currently gripping you. But may I say that if there is a fear in your heart today, that fear will be multiplied tomorrow. Fear never stays the same. It will either multiply and grip you, or you will defeat it today and be done with it. There are only two principles by which we will be motivated. The principle of fear and the principle of faith. Did you catch the two principles? Fear or faith. In the face of fear, God always says, have faith. From one end of the Bible to the other, you will hear this refrain. From Genesis to Revelation, you will come across this again and again and again. Do not fear. Abraham, do not be afraid. Joshua, be not afraid. Moses, don't be afraid. David, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. The disciples, don't be afraid. Do not fear. Defeat your fear. Our fears will destroy us. And we have to learn to hand our fears over to the Lord in prayer. It is what will finally grip us. So how we rejoice, it's not an option. And we can release a spirit of joy by developing our credibility and by defeating our fear. But after that, we come to the third key, which is how we think. So look at verse 8 with me. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Paul says, you and I are to think Christianly. He gives a whole list of things and he says, I want you to think. He is commanding us to think. We often don't spend time on the subject of thinking, do we? We don't think about thinking. We talk about relationships, we talk about our emotions, but we don't talk about our thinking. But Paul says in Ephesians, in Philippians, many times, use the mind that God has given us. In fact, in chapter 2 and verse 5, this is what it says. Will you read with me? Let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. You know, when Jesus was a boy, Luke writes that Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. Jesus had to grow in his mind. He had to develop a mindset. It took 30 years, but he had to develop his wisdom so that God could use him as the great Savior and Lord. When Solomon was asked by God, what will you have me give you? Solomon said, give me wisdom. And God said, I'm so thrilled by that request. I will not only give you wisdom, I'll give you riches and long life as well. I think Christians find it easy to think about relationships and emotions, But we struggle sometimes to talk about thinking. In fact, when we meet people who want to think, we think they are being a little secular. Because why should you think if you are a spiritual person? But really, we have to love God with all our mind. Remember, Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Look in the Old Testament. You don't find the word mind in that verse. Jesus added the mind because he was making a point. We have to love God with our mind. So how can you and I cultivate a Christian mind? I find that reading and studying the scripture is a wonderful way to develop a Christian mind. When I was a young Christian, I used to watch television a lot. Until one day I read a book that talked about the influence of television on our mind. And I realized that it's true. I was thinking about trivial things. I was distracted by many things. So I decided to transfer from watching TV to reading the Bible. And what a blessing it was, as my mind was fed on the Word of God rather than on the programs of television. Today is our phone destroying our mind. I fear that young people will grow up to find that their mind is not able to hold on to a thought, because we go from one quick thing to the next. Constantly, Instagram, everything moving so fast, Snapchat, it's Snapchat. And our mind can't do that. We need to cultivate the mind to be able to think according to the way God wants us to think. Paul says, whatever, 6 times. Whatever is good, whatever is beautiful, whatever is lovely, whatever is praiseworthy, whatever is true, think about such things. I want to encourage you to think about God's word, but also think about God's world. In the book of Psalms, the psalmists were thinking about God's world, and they said, when I look at the heavens, when I look at the plants and the animals, I see the glory of God. And so we have to be people who are thinking about God's word and about God's world. And when we think of these are the two books God has given us. There is the written word and the created word. God's created world through which he speaks to us. And so we are able to see God's thoughts as we give ourselves in our Christian mind. Finally, how we act. Paul says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice. Literally, he says, do these things. Christianity finally comes down to doing. There is far too much talking, far too much speculating, far too little doing. I'm sorry to say, it's true of my life, and you might find it's very true of you, that we find it easier to talk and to think than to. What does James say? Be doers of the word and not hearers only. This is what one person wrote. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather that you walk with me than merely show the way. The eye is a better pupil, more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is confusing, but example is always clear. And the best of all the preachers are the men who live their creeds. For to see a good put in action is what everybody needs. The practical key. You and I must commit ourselves to doing the things that God tells us about today. I remember years ago, Harsha Athurupan, a friend, said, God's word becomes boring today because we did not obey it yesterday. Did you catch that? I thought that was a great truth. When you are not obeying God's word, it becomes boring. It becomes meaningless. But when we are doing what God says, it comes alive. Educationists tell us that we remember most what we do. In fact, 90% of what we do, we will remember. So I close then with a small story from my ministry as a youth pastor. I used to teach the young people about loving God and loving neighbor. Loving God was easy to teach because they knew we must love God with our heart and mind and soul and strength. But loving neighbor was kind of theoretical. Until one day there was a great flood in Colombo. And we decided that we will do something. So we bought lots of lunch packets and we went looking for a community that was destitute in Kalani. And when these young people took these packets and walked through the mud and gave this food to people who were desperate for food, and they started talking to the women who were weeping, and they were talking, looking at the little children walking in the mud, as they engaged with loving their neighbor, We didn't have to teach it anymore. For the next year, they spent all their pocket money building houses. 17 houses they built. And they did ministry, they visited, they did medical clinics, they did the Jesus film, they did all kinds of things. You didn't have to tell them about loving the neighbor, because by doing, it had become a part of their Christian life. So four keys. Will you tell me the four keys? Let's say it together. How we relate, how we rejoice, how we think, and how we act. To be standing firm in the Lord, dear friends. Will you pray with me as we conclude? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this morning and for each other, for the church and our relationships. Thank you for the joy of the Lord that is our strength. Thank you for the mind of Christ. And thank you for the challenge to do the things that we have learned. In Jesus' name, amen.